Aqui no Spotify, muitas playlists são criadas através de inteligência artificial. A IA está em todo lugar, mas nem toda IA é igual. Desbloqueie experiências de IA mais inteligentes, fáceis de expandir e personalizadas para sua vida e seus negócios com os computadores Lenovo e processadores Intel Core Ultra, que transformam a sua experiência tecnológica. Acesse lenovo.com/smarterai. Lenovo, inteligência artificial mais inteligente para todos.
A magia do futebol. Somos diferentes, mas torcer nos faz parecidos. Não importa se você assiste com a camisa da sorte, no bar com amigos ou em casa na poltrona.
Preparou, vai bater, é gol! Gol!
Se você é o que grita mais alto, o que só comemora depois do replay, cada um torce do seu jeito. Coca-Cola, torcer é pra todos.
Tá a fim de ver os grandes craques do futebol europeu? Tá com aquela vontade de ver um golaço? Um clássico do futebol inglês ou el clássico espanhol? A gente tá contigo. Contigo e com o Vini Júnior, o Haaland, o Mbappé e muito mais. O Disney Plus tá com tudo. E o melhor futebol do mundo tá no Disney Plus. Assista ao futebol europeu ao vivo no Disney Plus.
Uma pausa no seu podcast para contar que chegou o novo Peugeot 2008, um carro que impressiona até quem já viu de tudo. Conheça uma experiência de puro prazer em dirigir com acabamento sofisticado e design inconfundível. Descubra como conforto e tecnologia podem elevar o nível da sua experiência de direção. Conheça o novo Peugeot 2008 e deixe a inspiração te guiar.
Welcome to the Chalkboard, my fellow football nerds, for episode number 172 of Chalk Talk. I'm your host, Shane Haff, and you can follow me on Twitter and YouTube at ShaneHaffNFL. I'm joined today by the best co-host in the game. You've heard him on the Tough Cover radio show. It is Mark Henry Jr. Give him a follow on Twitter at MarkHenryJr_. Mark, how are you doing today?
Good, actually. I spent my morning yelling at people online, so that's usually not good, but... For a loss Monday, I guess when the Eagles win, it's a victory Monday. But on the loser Mondays, I'm usually pretty depressed. And in an Eagles game where there's no Lane Johnson, A.J. Brown, or Devontae Smith, I'm not too down. So happy we're not talking about the Eagles, but excited to talk about the rest of the NFL.
Yeah, for the longtime listeners of the show that go way back when, like, our first 20 minutes of the show was recapping the Eagles game, I'm really happy that we moved away from that format and we're focusing on the NFC East and the rest of the NFL now, because I'm not ready to talk about it yet, but I am ready to talk about the rest of the NFL. And so we're going to dive in. And as we always do, we will start with the NFC East games and then we'll throw it around to the rest of the league, obviously excluding the dual Monday night games, which, by the way, like, is this just a new thing? Are we doing two Monday night games now? I remember it being occasional. I don't remember it happening like this frequently in the past.
So it used to be only week one.
Right.
And it would be a West Coast game. It would usually be like Chargers, Raiders, and Chris Berman would call it sometimes for ESPN. That used to be how it was done. There was a 7 o'clock game and a 10 o'clock game. Now they just do the 7:30 and the 8:15 to stagger the fourth quarters, I guess. I think it's a great idea. I mean, how many times do we have Monday night football games where we're sitting around tweeting about how much it sucks and how it's 21-0 and or how it's 9-0 in the fourth quarter and it's an ugly game or whatever the case may be? I think more than anything, it just gives you two chances at having a fun football game to watch. So I'm in on it. I'm in on it. I like it. I know a lot of people don't like it, but that's where I'm at on it. It seems like the first time they did it in the middle of the year was last year. The Eagles played, I believe they played the Vikings, and there was another game on at the same time. Then I think they did it one more time later in the year. I don't know if there's more of these on the schedule going forward or if this is just kind of an early season thing. I'm all about it. I know next week only has one.
Week 7 has two. I'm scrolling through the schedule right now, and it so far I'm to week 12. There's not any more. So, yeah, it looks like week 7 will do it again, and then maybe there's no more unless they flex some games. I don't think they can change games when they flex them. Week 15 has a double Monday game.
And then and it looks 13, like that's it. Weeks 13, 16, and 17 are all kind of crazy because of holiday stuff with either Thanksgiving or –
yeah.
Don't even look at week 16 and week 17 and get ready for how much football there's going to be for like a 9-day period. Actually, you know what? This is a good time to do it. Why not? We're at the top of the pod.
We're going to open the pod with our final thoughts. Let's talk NFL scheduling. I'm going to put that in the podcast description. Final thoughts at 2 minutes. And then
final thoughts to open the pod. But for the college football fans out there as well, the college football playoff starts on December 20th. There is an NFL game Thursday, December 19th. There is one college football playoff game Friday, the December 20th. There are three college football playoff games the 20th or the 21st, rather, on Saturday, along with two NFL games that day. Then there's a full NFL Sunday. Then there's Monday Night Football on the 23rd. And then they decided to play Christmas games on Wednesday. And then there's a game on Thursday. And then the college football playoff picks up again on that Friday. So that like week of time is going to be literally wall to wall insanity football. Save your PTO days. Maybe, I don't know if you're working in an industry where you've got to work around the holidays, but it's going to be a crazy, I don't know what spawns that, but that it's going to be a crazy holiday season for football.
Hot take. It's bad for the game of football. There's competitive things that are bad for it, but one of the things that I've always loved about football is you have a game a week. It's on Sunday. I mean, there's a Thursday night game, a Monday night game, whatever, but it's not watered down to like baseball or basketball where it just feels like there's games every day and you can't possibly keep up with them. I think long term, a little bit of it's fine. Like it's cool to have a game. It's cool to have games on Thanksgiving when you're sitting around the table with your family and you would really rather not talk about politics. You can tune everyone out and watch football instead. It's nice. You know, it's cool to have like a Christmas Eve game, unless it's on a Tuesday. Like that's cool. But like at a certain point we swing too far in the other direction and people are going to just start to not keep up with it all. So be careful, NFL.
I agree with that. I definitely agree with that. I have my own feelings that they should stay away from Christmas out of respect to the NBA. It's literally the one day they get, but the NFL doesn't care about the NBA. So that's a whole other thing.
I mean, I think they should just stay away from Christmas because it's literally on a Wednesday.
Yeah. That's right.
All right. Well, that is our final. I'm not even going to ask for final thoughts at the end. I'm just going to outro the podcast after Sunday Night Football. So there's our final thoughts. Now we're going to dive into the games. And let's start with a game that's been a few days now. Thursday Night Football, though. Dallas at the Giants after back-to-back disastrous home losses. The Cowboys went on the road for a get-right game against the Giants, and it looked like they were headed for that. They jumped out to a 14-6 lead, and then it got kind of ugly. They have 11 penalties for 89 yards. Brandon Aubrey missed a 51-yard field goal with 32 seconds left, which, by the way, we just like passed the crown from Justin Tucker to Brandon Aubrey. I meant like the best kicker crown, not the go miss kicks crown, but whatever. gave the Giants a chance. They obviously didn't come through. The Cowboys win 20-17. You could say, you know, if you're a Cowboys fan, you could take positives away from the fact that the run defense held the Giants to 1.1 yards per carry. Not that it's a good rushing offense, but they've been gashed the last 2 weeks. It was 49 rushing yards under expectation. But man, I don't think either team can walk away feeling good about this game because I mean, the Giants should have won this game. They made some key mistakes. Brian Daboll kicks a field goal down 14-9. To turn a one-score game into a one-score game in the third quarter. And then the Giants only cross midfield one time after that. You got Malik Nabers looks good, 12 receptions for 115 yards, but Daniel Jones has a horrific underthrow of what should have been a touchdown to him. Just not really a good performance by either team, and they sort of get the mini buy now to get right. The Giants aren't going to get right. The Cowboys get the mini buy here to get right, but I think there's still a lot of reasons for concern in Dallas.
Yeah, no, I think there definitely is. They won this game for one reason and one reason only, and it's Dak Prescott. I thought Dak was awesome in this game. 22 for 27, 221 yards, two touchdowns. It's not going to blow your, you know, like blow you away looking at the stat sheet, but it just felt like he was overcoming so many stupid penalties that would back them up, or not being able to have a run game, or not having anyone to rely on outside of CeeDee Lamb in the passing attack. They went to Ferguson a lot, but you know, seven catches. He only had 49 yards. His longest catch was for 9 yards. So it's not like that's stretching the field, really. So I felt like this was just a Dak masterclass. He had a throw on second down towards the end of the game to when they were getting towards the red zone. And it was just like, yeah, that's why Dak's one of the best quarterbacks in football. But I mean, outside of Dak in this game, is there a positive? You said the run defense. That's fair. The run defense and Dak Prescott, I don't know if anything else is positive for Dallas coming out of this.
Yeah, they still have no rushing attack, which is concerning. They've got, like I said, the run defense was good, but you're playing a bad opponent. So they're just going to have to, they're going to have to do that over the course of a couple games, I think, before you start to trust it.
Yeah, and it's Devin Singletary. He stinks. The Giants rushing attack stinks. It's probably one of the worst in football. So I'm not really going to – I don't trust it at all, to be honest. I don't think it was noteworthy in terms of going forward. Like, I don't think that they're going to all of a sudden be a good run defense. They have serious problems at linebacker that I don't think you're going to overcome. So, yeah, I think Dallas is probably like an 8 or 9 win team. 7, 8, 9 win team as long as Dak's healthy. They were really poorly coached in this game, just how many penalties there were. I will say it actually kind of felt like – not to be, it's kind of a funny thing to say. It did feel like they got the short end of the whistle a little bit in that game. Felt like they kind of couldn't get any rhythm going. They were kind of getting these constant ticky-tack fouls against them. And I know that the penalties were like 12-3 or 11-3 or something like that. But the Giants did move the ball on their defense. They most of the game, they were able to kind of move the ball through the air, whether that be Neighbors or Wandale. So, yeah, I don't think you walk out of this game feeling good at all if you're Dallas. And if you're the Giants, you feel like you just blew a chance to actually have an, you know, relevant football season. If you open your season 2-2, now 1-3, looking down the barrel at a pretty tough schedule coming up, it's, you know, that's probably your season right there, is not scoring a touchdown.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's go to the other game that is a little more recent. Maybe we can talk about some things people haven't heard as much. It's always stinks when one of your feature games was a Thursday night game and you're recording on a Monday, but let's get into yesterday afternoon. Washington just destroys Arizona on the road, 42-14. And the Commanders offense is rolling right now. Jaden Daniels goes 26 of 30 for 233 yards and a touchdown. He did have an interception. He rushed 8 times for 47 yards and a touchdown. And through 4 games, he's completing 82% of his passes, which is the highest completion percentage in recorded NFL history over a 4-game stretch. Washington generated 449 yards of total offense. They put up 42 points. And the Commanders move into first place in the NFC East, just like we all predicted before the season started. And, you know, we've talked about their defense, and their defense is maybe what prevents them from being a serious threat. They sacked Kyler Murray 4 times. They only allowed 3 rushing yards from Murray. The Cardinals only put up 14 points. And so for Washington, I mean, honestly, the question is, how good could this team be? Can they sustain this pace? Like, you expect the offense to come back down to earth a little bit, and you do play 2 pretty good defenses in the next 2 weeks in Cleveland and Baltimore. But if they can get through those games, I mean, I would expect them to go beat Cleveland. And if the offense looks good doing it, and then if they're able to, even if they go lose to the Ravens to fall 4-2, but they look competitive doing it. I mean, are we sitting here in a couple of weeks talking about Washington as a threat to potentially win the NFC East?
Yeah, no, I think they're a 9-10 ish win team. And it's actually, at this point, I think we know their offense is going to be good. We know their offense is going to be very good, I think, at this point. I think what we need to find out is what their defense is. And that's probably, if you're a Commanders fan or, you know, whatever, if you're rooting for the Commanders. That's probably the most important takeaway from this game, is that the Cardinals' offense looked broken. I'm choosing to believe that the Cardinals' offense has serious problems outside of this game. You look at the last nine quarters they've played. That's a little bit of cherry picking, because you're using the fourth quarter of a game that they did blow out the Rams in. But the last nine quarters they've played, they've scored 34 points. And you look yesterday's game, they go right down the field, open the game. I know this was a very popular over, and it did end up getting there with no help of the Cardinals. I know it was sitting up there high at like 50-51, and it cashed to 56. The Cardinals scored right down the field, then Washington went back and answered, and you're sitting there like, oh, this game's going to be like 45-40. But then Arizona scored with 10 minutes to go in the first quarter. They did not score again for 35 more minutes of game time. Not a field goal. Then obviously they only put up 14, so they scored another touchdown with about 5 minutes or 2 minutes left of the third quarter. So really, really brutal offensive performance from Arizona. You look at the box score, and you look at Kyler, 16 for 22. Yeah, that looks good. He only had 142 passing yards. They took away everything deep. It feels like Arizona forgot they had Marvin Harrison Jr. for large stretches of this game, which we hadn't seen that since week one. But yeah, I'm choosing to believe that I don't think Washington took some big step defensively. I think it's probably more about Arizona having problems on offense. But yeah, Washington's offense at this point, you can say, is 100% legitimate.
Yeah, that Washington ranks second in offensive DVOA and 30th in defensive DVOA. So they're going to have to keep scoring at a high pace and hope. And I mean, to be fair, Dan Quinn's a good defensive coach. And so there's obviously some personnel limitations there, but I do trust that Quinn is going to get the most that you could possibly get out of that defense if your name's not Brian Flores. So I feel like that defense will probably improve, at least to the degree that's possible, as the season progresses.
And you look at, I don't know, it's bad because I know we're supposed to cover the NFC East and talk about that. I think Arizona's the more interesting conversation coming out of this game, because what are they? They're going to San Fran next week. They're an 8-point underdog. Like, kind of felt like they were 3.5-point favorite in this game against Washington, and I bet it like an idiot. But as stupid as you know, Washington just looked so good on Monday Night Football, you'd think that that they would have gotten favored in the game. Arizona was favored big. They were favored against the Rams a couple weeks ago, and then now it seems like Vegas has kind of jumped off the ship with them. They ran the crap out of the ball in this game. 181 yards on the ground, 5.7 yards per carry. James Conner had over 100 yards and a touchdown. This is a Cardinals passing offense issue. I don't know. I guess I'll throw it to you on that. Like, what do you think about what's going on with the Cardinals? Is their OC a moron? Because they did a pretty good job in week two and week three, it felt like, offensively. But, or at least the week two and then the first half of week three offensively. But, man, I'm pretty worried about Arizona.
Yeah. I mean, Drew Petzing is a guy that we talked about maybe getting head coach offers after last season. And I can't put a finger on what seems off. Kyler seems kind of shaky at times back there. It seems like at certain points they funnel the offense through Marvin Harrison and it goes really well. And then at certain points he's just taken out of the game. Mm-hmm. I really don't know what to make of the Arizona offense so far, because this is a team that early in the year is like, they might be pretty good. And now you sit here after a performance like this against a defense that's, like we said, not very good. And I don't know what to make of that.
They lost. Kyler lost 27 yards on sacks, took 4 sacks in this game. That's a lot of yards to lose on sacks. And that's a Kyler issue, you know, with him not being able to see over the line. He drops back pretty far. And then if he gets pressured, he tends to go backwards. And that's fun when he runs around and makes a crazy play, but it's not fun when you take, what, I mean, what's that per sack? How many yards? Like, that's over
like seven.
That's 7 yards a sack.
6.75.
I mean, that's like taking you out of field goal range sometimes. That's taking you, you know, from a 1st and 10 to a 2nd and 17. Like, that ends the drive, it feels like, a little bit in some ways. So maybe that's part of the problem, but yeah, Arizona's a team I kind of picked to be the dark horse 7th playoff team. And Washington was staring at me right in the face. I picked Washington to win eight games, but that should have been Washington, not Arizona, clearly. So, yeah, I'm kind of ready to abandon ship on Arizona. Jonathan Gannon hasn't gotten the defense going yet this year, it feels like. And the offense has serious problems at this point. So I think we might be seeing the last year of whatever regime this is in Arizona. I'm willing to throw that out there at this point.
We've got a comment from Anthony here asking, any chance defenses get a book on the Washington offense and slow them down? I think it's certainly a possibility. I mean, Jaden Daniels has the sixth fastest time to throw right now and the fourth lowest average depth of target. So they're a very horizontal offense. That's not to say that he can't hit deep shots, because he's certainly done that. But I think anytime you get a new quarterback, new scheme, there's always a chance that you're unable. I mean, I don't think he's going to complete 82% of his passes on the year. I think eventually defenses are going to start to adjust and take away things that the Commanders are doing right now. It's what's the counterpunch from Cliff Kingsbury, a guy who I have traditionally hated on a lot, that seems to be doing a really good job this year. So what's the counterpunch? What we've seen throughout Cliff's career is that he doesn't have that. Maybe this is turning over a new leaf, so we'll have to see as the season progresses. But I certainly think defenses will start to make adjustments, and it'll all be on what Kingsbury and Daniels are able to do from there.
Yeah, maybe he's an OC. Maybe he's not a head coach and one of those guys. But looks like the way this is going, I think he's probably going to end up getting another chance, getting another head coaching job, which is very funny. But
in before Arizona fires Jonathan Gannon and hires Cliff Kingsbury.
That'd be funny. But I was about to ask, like, if they fire Gannon, is he going to be back as the Eagles DC? And then I forgot that we have a blood feud against Jonathan Gannon.
Can you imagine Gannon back to Philly, Cliff Kingsbury back to Arizona?
I'd sign up right now, by the way.
All right. Well, let's roll on into the rest of the slate on Sunday. And we'll start off in New Orleans, where the Atlanta Falcons won 26-24, despite not scoring an offensive touchdown. They hit four field goals, recovered a muff punt in the end zone, and had a pick six and win the game 26-24. I feel like the noteworthy thing about this game, so the Falcons get the ball back after New Orleans scored a touchdown with a minute left to take a one-point lead. Kirk Cousins throws five passes. He completed one of them for 5 yards, and then they were in field goal range because of a 30-yard defensive pass interference on Paulson Adebo that moved Atlanta. So it's even worse than that. It's a 5-yard completion on first down, then a false start that gives that yardage back up. And then DPI, and then three straight incomplete passes, and then they hit the 58-yard field goal as time expires. So just like you get, like, Kirk Cousins gets the game-winning drive here, despite the fact the offense moved 0 yards unabated by penalties. It was very anticlimactic game-winning drive, but I guess it counts nevertheless.
And by the way, the strategy that was being employed on this drive was insane. They were taking like deep shots to like the 5-yard line. I don't know what Zach Robinson was on in this game, because they moved the ball. They ran the ball 15 times in this game. Bijan Robinson, I don't know if Arthur Smith like was calling the plays, but Bijan Robinson had 7 carries and Algier had 8. Algier had more carries. He was better, but it was just, it was a really bizarrely called game. It felt like the exact right time to be running the ball just to get a couple more yards for your kicker. And they were taking these deep shots with 12 seconds left in the game. They had no timeouts. They had, this is after they had gotten the pass interference. They're sitting on the 40. He throws like a 25-yard out that would have gotten them to the 15 to Darnell Mooney. Darnell Mooney was like diving to catch it. He would have landed in bounds. Paulson Adebo made like a good play and reached out and like batted it away. I guess you'd call it a good play. If Paulson Adebo doesn't bat that ball away, Darnell Mooney catches that ball in bounds and the clock absolutely runs out before they can kick a field goal. It was 12 seconds left when they started the play. There was 2 seconds, or I think there was like 7 seconds left when they ended the play. They would have had to run an entire field goal unit out there. They didn't have a timeout. It was some of the wildest strategy I've ever seen And it didn't matter because kickers are good now. And Young Hoku hits a 58-yarder. And I think it was like 5 yards longer than his career long, which is a crazy game. And the Falcons also made a stop on the 1 yard line with about like, I'd have to look here, about four, I'd say they made the stop with 3 minutes and 57 seconds left on the 1 yard line. The Saints had 4th and goal on the 1, down 6. Falcons make the stop. I had Falcons -2.5 in this game. And I finally felt like, all right, we're good. Like, we're going to get a first down and we'll punt it away, whatever. And then the Saints get the ball back and they go right down the field and score like immediately after the Falcons go 3 and out after that. And so then it's 24-23. And then that sets up the end of the game. Wild game. I just an insane game.
Yeah, it's interesting. On the edge of field goal range, he threw passes with 25, 35, and 20 air yards.
Like, it was insane. They didn't have a timeout. It was insane.
Yeah, it was bizarre. And I'm with you. Like, I might not run it, but I would be trying. I feel like in that situation, I'm trying to throw the 5 to 8 yard middle of the field route and then get on the ball and spike it and set up the field goal attempt. But you're absolutely right. Like, that one pass that Paulson Adebo broke up, I don't think Mooney gets out of bounds if that's completed and the game the game's over. It was crazy. I did not know what I was watching.
It was insane. It was funny because I was watching from the lens of I had Falcons -2.5. So I was hoping for like a breakaway, break free touchdown so that they take the lead by more than they win the game by 2. So I lose on the hook. It sounds like I've been complaining about gambling. I actually had like the best gambling day of my life in the NFL yesterday, but this was what I lost by the hook. And I was hoping for like a big play. And even I was like, why are they trying to score? Like, why are they trying? Do they not trust Koo? Like, me and my friend were literally like talking it out, like trying to figure out what Zach Robinson was thinking. And it was like trying to figure out what Nick Sirianni's thinking on an hourly basis. It was insane.
Maybe he misread the scoreboard. Maybe he just thought they were down 4 or something.
It was wild. I couldn't believe it.
All right, well, let's keep rolling on. Let's go to Cincinnati at Carolina. The Bengals finally get their first win of the year, 32-24. Joe Burrow had a mostly good performance. He did throw one interception, but the run game operated at a high level with Chase Brown, who, by the way, big fans of in the draft. Chase Brown and Zach Moss combined for 131 yards and 2 touchdowns on 30 carries. For the Panthers, Andy Dalton was 25 of 40 for 220 yards and 2 touchdowns. He did throw an interception. Chuba Hubbard rushed for 104 yards and a touchdown. Deontay Johnson caught a touchdown. Xavier Leggett caught his first career touchdown, and Mark was a huge Xavier Leggett guy. I thought I was a big Xavier Leggett guy until we stacked him on our big board. I was like, holy crap, Mark loves this guy. Andy Dalton continues to inject life into an offense that just doesn't have it with Bryce Young. Like, I think the big takeaway with Panthers fans is like, yeah, Bryce Young is toast. He's the problem. It's just not going to work. And on the Cincinnati side, Cincinnati's defense continues to be a big problem. Like, they gave up 38 points to Washington last week, who we already talked about. They gave up 375 yards of offense to the Panthers. Like, there is nothing they do well. And then Trey Hendrickson also left this game with an injury, and he's probably the best player on their defense. So Cincinnati gets their first win, but this defense, it's untenable. I struggle to see the Bengals as a serious football team with this defense.
Ravens -2.5 at Cincinnati last week or next week all day long. I love the Ravens to go into Cincy and send them to 1-4 after they finally feel a little bit better about themselves for the win. This defense is broken. They have serious problems. Luan Arumo, you know, he was like a potential head coach at one point. He might get fired as a DC at this point. They're just doing a terrible job there. The Panthers ran all over them. They do not have a good rushing attack. One of the worst in football. Chuba Hubbard, not a good player. Miles Sanders, not a good player. 5.3 yards per carry. This was the game I was probably focused on least at the 1 o'clock hour. Bengals offense, I don't have really many concerns about. I said that after last week's game against the Commanders. They lost that game because of the defense, and this game was only close in some way because of the defense. So this game was within a touchdown for most of the fourth quarter. Like the Panthers had chances to tie this game. So I wouldn't walk out of this game thinking like, all right, Bengals are fixed. We're all good. We're back on track. We're going to be the 0-3 team that makes the playoffs again. I don't think so.
All right. Yeah, I don't think so either, by the way. I just don't see it. Let's keep rolling to Los Angeles, where the Chicago Bears pick up a win 24-18 over the Rams. The Bears finally got a run game going this week. DeAndre Swift bounced back from his 13-carry, 20-yard performance last week, had 16 for 93 and a touchdown. He was also the leading receiver with 72 yards through the air. DeAndre Swift had more total yards in week four than he had in weeks 1 through 3 combined. And it should probably be concerning for Bears fans that the wide receiver trio of DJ Moore, Keenan Allen, and Rome Odunze combined for 51 yards on the day. Like that should probably be concerning. But at the end of the day, you get a win. The Rams couldn't overcome being down their top two wide receivers. Stop me if you've heard that before about other teams. Stafford completed a high percentage of his passes, but he threw a pick. He took a fumble. He took three sacks. He lost a fumble and took three sacks. Los Angeles did outgain Chicago 322 to 264. They had more first downs, but they could not put up points. And so they miss a field goal. Stafford's turnovers, it all adds up and sinks the Rams. So I think one thing Rams fans should be excited about is Jared Verse, who looks like the real deal. We shouted him out last week on the show. He had 5 pressures in this game, and 4 of them were under 2.5 seconds. So Jared Verse looks legit. Unfortunately, they're just too banged up offensively right now.
Yeah, the whole Bears can run the ball thing. The Rams run defense stinks. We've seen it multiple times now. I don't think that's a turned corner for Chicago. I think it was just a matchup thing. And it's funny because they won this game. I bet on Chicago. I've watched every Bears game pretty closely. You look at this game and you look at the stat sheet for Caleb, 17 for 23, 157 yards, a touchdown, no picks, no turnovers. And you might think like, yeah, not a lot of yards, but he played better. I actually thought that there was like less positive takeaways. And maybe I'm just like the interception apologist at this point, and I'm like apologizing for turnovers. But I actually thought in the last 2 weeks that he did have 2 picks in each game, he had more throws that you could look at and be like, there's Caleb Williams. And there's why we really talked about this guy's a generational prospect and all these things. In this game, it felt like they really came in with a really vanilla game plan. They were throwing to their running backs and tight ends a ton and just not really getting enough targets to their 3 really good wide receivers, only 12 targets for all 3 on the day. I didn't, it worked out because they ran the ball and they won the game, but pretty disheartening game if you're like hoping for Caleb to kind of bust out and break out a little bit from a statistical standpoint. Cause I thought this was the game that could happen because the Rams defense in general is pretty susceptible. You look at what Purdy did last week without Debo and without George Kittle. Juwan Jennings had like the best game he'll ever have in his career. And now this week they lost the game. They won the game. They scored 24 points, all that stuff. I just was hoping to see more from Caleb yesterday. And it feels weird for that to be kind of my leading point here on a Bears win. But I thought, because I've been a Caleb guy and even a defender through the first 3 weeks, I thought we would have saw more. I don't know if that's really him or if the offensive coordinator was kind of making the game plan a bit more vanilla to avoid the mistakes that they had kind of been plaguing them, but just kind of how I felt watching the game.
Yeah. Yeah. It's, I don't know. It just hasn't been what I expected so far in Chicago. And at this point, I'm not sure it's going to be like the approach doesn't seem to, I don't know. It's been very weird. Not as weird as some other things in the division though. Minnesota, Green Bay, another one that's like, yeah, we all expected Minnesota to
real quick. Just one kind of thing I'll throw out there. DJ Moore is apparently like sitting by himself at the end of every offensive possession and doesn't leave with the team after games. He like waits 10 minutes on the sideline and sits there while everyone leaves and goes back to the locker room. And then he goes back. Weird thing that people were kind of talking about on Twitter. And he had the clip last week where he went up to Tyson Bagent and said, like, we need you out here, dog, when Caleb missed him with a throw. So it seems like Caleb Williams and DJ Moore not at all getting along. Because it's funny, the DJ Moore got traded to Chicago. That trade is what allowed Caleb Williams to be a Bear. But the guy that came in the trade that allowed Caleb Williams to be a Bear doesn't like Caleb Williams. It's like a funny, I don't know.
Yeah, interesting. If just pro tip, if you're a wide receiver out there that playing for a team with a rookie number one overall draft pick at quarterback, you should probably try to be friends with the guy, because if somebody might go somewhere, but it's not going to be him.
He scored a touchdown. They won the game. Like, I know he didn't have a good game, but like, come on, DJ Moore. Like, yeah. What are you doing? You're not like Justin Jefferson, whereas if you have like three catches, it's like a national story. Like, I
yeah. Well, speaking of the crazy things in that division.
Yeah. Yeah.
Minnesota at Green Bay. And I mean, just like we all expected, Minnesota losing their rookie quarterback in training camp was going to be 4-0 and leading the division over the Packers and over the Lions, teams we thought were legitimate contenders. And maybe they still are, but man, it's been impressive to see what Minnesota's been able to do. And they jumped out to a 28-0 lead in this game. Their first three drives went for touchdowns, and they averaged 8 yards per play. And they punted on drives four, but then they got an interception and a 4-yard touchdown to go up 28-0. Now, after that, they almost let the Packers come back. They were outscored 29-3 for the rest of the game. But, you know, they hold on and they win. Jordan Love really struggled early in this game. He threw two interceptions on the first four possessions. Now, he did get hot in the fourth quarter, and he threw three touchdowns as part of that furious comeback effort. He ended the game with career highs in yards at 389, touchdowns with four, and interceptions with three. And so, rough game there for Jordan Love coming back. I don't think the Packers need to like freak out. I mean, it's not ideal that you're 2-2 and your starter has played only two games and you lost both of them. But still, he's coming back from an injury. You don't play a lot in preseason, all that stuff. You can give all those caveats for the Packers. But I want to talk about the Vikings. Mark, are the Vikings legitimate contenders with Sam Darnold at quarterback? I mean, they have wins over the 49ers, the Texans, and the Packers in the last 3 weeks. Now they have the Jets and the Lions up next. So I feel like we're going to continue to learn a lot about this team, but if they get through that Jets and Lions stretch, like if they're sitting here at 6-0 in a couple weeks, it'd be a very impressive performance for a team that, again, I can't stress this enough, is starting Sam Darnold at quarterback.
Yeah. I mean, Darnold's playing way better than I think anyone thought he could. And KOC is the head coach of the year by far. Kevin O'Connell, who I've been really high on for years here and think he's one of the best coaches in football. I will say the Packers had three picks, a fumble, and two missed field goals in this game. So I think there's a lot of ways this game plays out where the Vikings don't win it. And the Vikings, it played out exactly how they needed it to, where they got up early. They were able to sit on the ball. And even though the Packers came back, they were up by a big enough margin that there just wasn't enough time, and the Packers ran out of time, it felt like, because it did feel like Green Bay figured out something with the defense, that they were able to move the ball better than these other teams have been able to move the ball. And even scoring 29 points, first 3 weeks, the Vikings gave up 6, 17, and 7. It's a good quarterback. I said last week that I don't think this defense, the defensive performance, is sustainable for the talent that's on the field. And I think what Flores is doing is downright wizardry. Like, I can't even imagine. I think this might be the best job I've ever seen a defensive coordinator do for a football team, given how low my opinion is of the talent on the roster. It's incredible. I do think Green Bay figured it out a bit in the second half, and I think that they probably put some tape out there for teams to figure it out. Now, they turned it over a couple times in that midst of figuring it out, and maybe that's what happens, but I refuse to believe that the Vikings defense can continue doing what they were doing for the first three games in the first half of this game. That's kind of the X factor, because I think that they are going to need the defense to be good or to be extremely good. And I just can't buy it. It's actually not even about Sam Darnold. It's actually about the defense. And I just think this can't be sustainable.
Yeah, we saw the defense fade last year, like you mentioned, and we'll see. It feels like writing that is unsustainable. I don't know. We'll see. We'll see how it goes. So
my answer would be no. I don't think they're a Super Bowl contender. They'll be in the playoffs now, 4-0. They can win that division potentially. I probably would still lean Detroit, but they could absolutely win that division. They will be in the playoffs, but I close my eyes. I can't picture them in the Super Bowl. So, yeah.
All right. Well, let's go to Jacksonville, where Houston beats the Jags 24-20. They dropped the Jags to 0-4. Houston scored on three of their four first half possessions. Then they had back-to-back three and outs to start the second half and five consecutive drives ending in punts. Then they get the ball down four with under 3 minutes left, and they went on a nine-play, 69-yard touchdown drive to win the game. Or down three. I said down four. They won by four, so it had to be down three, I think. Mm-hmm. I might have written that down wrong. Anyways, the Jags let another one get away. Yeah, it's three. They had it because I wrote down on the next line they had a three-point lead, so typoing all over the place here, but they had a 3-point lead in the ball with 3:51 left, and they went three and out and only took 46 seconds off the clock, throwing back-to-back incompletions, stopping the clock, giving the Texans time. And then the Texans answer, and CJ Stroud goes on the money drive and wins the game. And Nico Collins had a monster day in this one. He had 151 yards and one touchdown on 12 receptions. Nico Collins is currently on pace for a 2,000-yard season through four games. It is insane the connection that he has had with C.J. Stroud. So what's your takeaway here for the Texans, for the Jaguars? Obviously, there's a lot of negative takeaways for the Jaguars, but what are your thoughts after this one?
Did you see Doug's press conference?
No, I didn't.
Oh, man. You got to feel bad for the guy. I do think he's like genuinely a good dude, but someone just asked him how he felt about his job security, and he went, "That's a weird question, but okay." It's like, really? You're 0-4.
I feel like I remember that same response from an Eagles press conference with
Doug. I had the same feeling. I would have to go and find it. It felt like deja vu for sure from 2020. It's a shame. You gotta feel bad for Doug, but I would actually say, I know Houston won it. I feel like I'm taking a lot of the angles like this team won, but here's why you should be concerned. Maybe that's stupid to do, but Houston, they can't run the ball. And I know Joe Mixon wasn't out there today. Joe Mixon was there in week two. And you look at each game so far this year, in week two, the Texans, or in week one, the Texans ran all over the field. It's why they won the football game in week one with Joe Mixon going nuts. Week two, they ran for 3.4 yards per carry. Last week, they ran for 2.5 yards per carry. This week, Houston ran for 3.9 yards per carry, but they ran it 26 times. Like that's actually benefited by Stroud having 6 yards per carry, if you look into it. So they just cannot run the football right now, Houston, and it's hurting their offense from being as potentially, you know, really good as I think it could be. You know, you look at the last 3 weeks, 19, 7, and 24 points. And 24 decent, but if they could run the ball, that would have been a lot better, because I thought Stroud was mostly really awesome in this game. Might have been the best quarterback performance of the day. I'd have to go back and look at it. Jaden Daniels was really good as well. I'd have to look at it. But Stroud was so in control of this game, even when they were losing. It felt like he was just making big plays every time they needed one. Nico Collins, man, I mean, how many receivers are better right now than Nico Collins? I missed, I think, the week two episode, and you said you talked about that. And at that point, you asked me what Nico Collins, the top blank receiver. And I think I said probably fringe top 10. Uh-huh. I think we're at the point where he's fringe top five for sure.
Yeah. And you get into so much too of like, so much of thriving as a receiver is being in the right situation and having that connection with the quarterback, because like, you know, in a different situation, is he putting up these stats? Maybe not. There's so much in football that we have to contextualize, and that's hard to do. It's hard to remember as you look at it, but he's certainly on the same page with CJ Stroud, and they continue to put up huge numbers week after week.
Yeah, I mean, 15 targets in this game. There was one drive. He caught a touchdown, but it was out of bounds. They threw him another, but there was a flag. And then they were just like, all right, we're going to get him a touchdown. And they got him a touchdown anyway. Like, it just felt like their possession was like CJ Stroud and Nico Collins got together on the sideline. They're like, we're going to score a touchdown together.
We'll make it up to you. We'll get it.
Even if it doesn't work the first couple times, we'll make sure of it. But yeah, I mean, heartbreaking loss for Jacksonville. They were kind of like winning for most of the game. They started really hot on offense and kind of went away from passing the ball and went to running the ball, and it worked most of the time, but a couple bad possessions towards the end of the game, they have to give the ball back. And yeah, I didn't think Trevor was terrible in this game. He wasn't taking chances down the field, but I didn't think he was terrible in this game. This is just a weird one. They lost a close one that they probably should have won. Yeah, it's disappointing. I don't know how you fix this team.
Yeah, I don't either. Let's go on to Pittsburgh. The Indianapolis Colts beat the Pittsburgh Steelers 27-24, and the Anthony Richardson injury woes continue. And I'm mad at Shane Steichen on this one. Anthony Richardson leaves the game with a hip injury on the second drive. He returns two plays later, and on his first play back, the Colts called a design QB run. He takes a hit, and then he left the game for good. That's just that's indefensible. It's indefensible to put the guy back out there if he is hurt. It's even worse if you put him out there and immediately call a QB run. I guess you should argue, like, if he's not healthy enough for you to call the QB run, he shouldn't be on the field to begin with. Like, you could come at it from either way, but it was handled poorly. He's hurt now. Who knows what the prognosis will be long term on that. Joe Flacco comes in. We're going to do the Joe Flacco thing again. Joe Flacco goes 16-26 for 168 yards and two touchdowns in relief. The Steelers just, again, this is another team that let us start a bad start compound. They were down 17-0 after the Colts' first three possessions. And then they got a drive into the red zone and they had a fumble. And then they started to get rolling. They scored a touchdown on three consecutive drives in the second half to cut the lead to three. With under 4 minutes left, they get the three and out from the defense, and then they end up turning it over on downs after a fumbled snap exchange and gets them behind the sticks and all that. All in all, Justin Fields was 22 of 34 for 312 yards and a touchdown. He rushed for 55 yards and two touchdowns. He did lose a fumble. Pittsburgh picks up their first loss of the year. And honestly, it just feels like they started bad and it compounded, because the second half, I thought they still looked like a really good football team. So, you know, we'll point this one at people will point this one out down the road. If you're arguing about the legitimacy of the Steelers, be like, they lost to a backup 20, you know, in week four. But honestly, I think this is one where the game just got away from them really early.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think the game got away early. They're not a team designed to play from behind, even though I will say they did a pretty good job getting back into the game. They had a chance to win it at the end of the game. Justin Fields, 312 passing yards. He saw a lot that you have to love out of him being able to at least come from behind a little bit and put them back in position to win the game. He took some terrible, terrible sacks. Like, he took one that took them out of field goal range. You look at that score, they lost by three. If they kicked that field goal, probably a tie game at the end of the game where they're driving to win, not driving to tie, and ran for 55 yards, two touchdowns on the ground. I will say most of what you saw from Justin Fields, you're like, oh my God, this is the guy that we were hoping we could get as a franchise quarterback out of Ohio State. But you did see him peek through a couple of times there. He ran backwards and took a sack and then fumbled it. And that probably lost them the game. That fumbled sack and the sack he took that took him out of field goal range. If you just have one of those, you probably win the game. But you can't have both of those, and it lost them the game. So a lot to love with Fields, but a couple things that remind you of why he ended up on his second team in his fourth year in the league or whatever it is by now. Another thing, Najee Harris is not an NFL running back. Can we stop? Like, 13 carries for 19 yards. What are we doing? I know he had like 20 carries for like 70 yards in week one. He has 3.4 yards per carry this year. He's never rushed for more than 4.1 yards per carry in his career. He has 902 NFL carries. Can we get Najee Harris off the field? I'm done with it. Cordero Patterson, who looked, by the way, Cordero Patterson looked pretty fat out there. I had a weird take by me. He's supposed to be like a fast guy. He looked like Cordero Patterson. He was pretty slow. But even he, 6 carries, 43 yards, by the way. No reaction from my co-host on my Cordero Patterson joke.
Oh, I chuckled.
That was a good one. I cooked that one up yesterday. But he had 7 yards per carry. Like, throw him out there. I know Jalen Warren missed the game. He's got to get back. And they've got to really start using Jalen Warren because he's the best running back on the roster. They were throwing a guy named Aaron Shampkin out there who got a carry, and he was pass blocking a bit because Najee's not even that good of a pass blocker. It doesn't make sense. Get him out of the league. He's not good. He'll be an Eagle next year, by the way.
Who's the running back you said? I don't know if that's even a real person. I think you might have made him up.
Aaron Shampkin. He had Shampklin. He had 1 carry for 5 yards. He went to Harvard, actually.
So far this year, I was just looking this up. Najee Harris ranks 65th in the league in rushing DVOA.
How many running backs are there?
100 qualifying running backs.
I'm surprised it's not worse, honestly.
So, by the way, on Justin Fields, this was only Justin Fields' second 300-yard passing game of his career. The other one was also in a loss, Chicago versus Denver in 2023. But 2 of his top 8 passing performances in terms of yards have come this year with the Steelers. And so I do think there's something there. I think the Steelers, I mean, obviously, they were going to start Russell Wilson. They were really fortunate Russell Wilson got hurt because Justin Fields isn't giving that job up right now. And I do think it is the best for them long term. So we'll see what happens moving forward.
Something I wanted to mention with the Cowboys game and forgot to, but it works because Cowboys Steelers next week, Sunday Night Football, fun game. We can all wear black and gold and root for Justin Fields next Sunday night. But Tyler Guyton, really, really rough game, I felt like, from Tyler Guyton last Thursday against the Giants. Not only failing to kind of block in certain scenarios and getting Dak pressure, but he also single-handedly took them out of field goal range before the half. And then, he took them out of the 4th-and-1 range. And then Brandon Aubrey made a kick. And then later on took them out of field goal range again when they were about like right over the 50. He had multiple times where I felt like he really, really hurt the Cowboys in that game. And now there's a guy on the Steelers named TJ Watt, who I think they'll probably be lining up over Guyton as much as possible. I think that's going to be a matchup nightmare for the Cowboys next week, trying to block the Steelers pass rush.
Yeah, absolutely. We got a comment coming in on YouTube here that says, this has been such a weird season because after 4 weeks, I still feel like we know so little.
Especially the NFC.
Yeah, for sure. I kind of feel like we do that a bit every year. It's like we're a quarter of the way through the season. It's like, what have you learned? It's like, I don't know. let's get on to our final game in the early slate. We've got the Denver Broncos at the New York Jets. Man, what a sloppy game. Denver wins 10-9. It was the 11th drive before someone got a first down not produced by a penalty. Bo Nix was 7. Listen to this. Bo Nix was 7 of 15 for -7 passing yards at halftime. He was averaging -1 yards per completion. They won the game with 20 passing yards on 25 passing or 6. Sorry, 60 passing yards on 25 passing attempts. Aaron Rodgers took 5 sacks. He was only 24 of 42 passing. The Packers turned a 1st-and-goal at the 1 into a field goal after they got stuffed on 2 plays, threw an incomplete pass on 3rd-and-goal at the 1, then false started when they lined up to go for it on 4th-and-1. When you limit your opponent to 186 yards, you expect to win a game, and the Jets just could not get it done at home. And nobody wanted to win this game. In the final 2 minutes, there was a turnover on downs from the Jets, followed by a missed field goal by the Broncos, followed by a missed field goal by the Jets, all in the final 2 minutes of a 1-point game. Just a sloppy, sloppy game. Maybe you should say both defenses were really good, but kind of feels like both teams just deserve to lose.
I had Denver Broncos +8.5 as one of my biggest bets of the day. And I also sprinkled on Denver Broncos money line. And I tweeted it out a couple days ago. I like Denver to win this game outright. I just think this Jets offense has serious, serious problems. And I don't know if they're fixable, especially with Nathaniel Hackett at the helm calling the plays. Bo Nix was, I believe he was, I don't know if you said this, I was looking for the stat, so I was zoning out a little bit. I think he was 7-for-14 for -7 yards at halftime.
7-of-15 for -7 yards.
Yeah.
-1 yards per completion at halftime.
It's unbelievable. So I will say Denver ran the ball really well in this game. Javonte Williams, who was a guy I came into the year really high on. I thought Javonte Williams was going to have a big year for fantasy. Finally kind of looked like the guy he looked like towards the end of last year. I know he had an injury going into last year. It was really bad to start the year. Finished the year well. 16 carries for 77 yards yesterday, about 5 yards per carry almost. Then Jaleel McLaughlin had about 5 yards per carry as well. They really ran the ball well, and that's the only reason that Denver won this game, or the only reason that the offense allowed them to win this game. The defense, like, people are going to look at this and be like, man, the Broncos defense is really good. And I think they had a really good game plan coming into this game. They kind of just – Patrick Surtain right now is the best corner in football. I know we kind of like trade that between Sauce Gardner and others. If you look at the receivers, Surtain has shut down to start this year. Garrett Wilson, just add another one to the list there. 5 catches for 41, but I think a couple of those were not while he was getting covered by Surtain. They basically were like, let's just have Surtain take Garrett Wilson out. We're going to load the box on Breece Hall, and Aaron Rodgers doesn't have the mobility to beat us outside the box and doesn't trust anyone else other than Wilson and Hall in the lineup enough to beat us. And that's what happened. They played directly into what the Broncos' game plan was. Breece Hall, it might be time to have a conversation about Breece Hall, a guy who was going top five in fantasy. He's got 174 yards and 2 touchdowns, 3.1 yards per carry, hasn't eclipsed 63. He has 62 yards as a season high in 4 games so far. Part of what was supposed to be so good about the Jets and why I thought, you know, Aaron Rodgers just has to manage the game was because I thought not only do they have a great defense, but they have a great running game. I guess not.
Yeah.
10 carries for 4 yards. Like, they have serious problems on offense, whether it be their running game's not as good as we thought. Maybe Rodgers, not great in the pocket, took 5 sacks for 41 yards in this game. And then, you know, do they have a second guy that scares anyone? Mike Williams and Lazard had made a couple plays in this game, but, man, it's not looking good for the Jets. I thought, like, you know, you look at the schedule before. I always look at week 5 before week 4, just take a look at what's upcoming. And I saw Jets Vikings in London, and I was like, oh, I'll probably be on the Jets because I'm skeptical on the Vikings, and I've been kind of supportive of the Jets defense all year. But now, like, I don't know how I belly up to the bar and place that bet, Jets +2.5 against the Vikings in London. I don't feel great about the Jets in that game, so maybe the Vikings get to 5-0. But I think this game is so much more about the Jets than it is the Broncos. I don't know what this Jets offense does to fix itself.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm not sure either, because you just expected more, or maybe you didn't, because, you know, we had concerns about Rodgers coming off of the injury and things. And I think he's looked good at times, and this obviously wasn't one of those games, but it's gotta be frustrating as a Jets fan to have felt so all in on the Aaron Rodgers experience and it to end the way it did last year in week 1 and for it to look like this in year 2. It's definitely got to be concerning.
Yeah, I totally agree.
Aqui no Spotify, muitas playlists são criadas através de inteligência artificial. A IA está em todo lugar, mas nem toda IA é igual. Desbloqueie experiências de IA mais inteligentes, fáceis de expandir e personalizadas para sua vida e seus negócios com os computadores Lenovo e processadores Intel Core Ultra, que transformam a sua experiência tecnológica. Acesse lenovo.com/smarterai. Lenovo, inteligência artificial mais inteligente para todos.
Meu nome é Cairo Santos e eu sou kicker e único brasileiro jogando na NFL. Cada chute, cada jada conquistada, cada passo me levou para mais perto dos meus sonhos. Agora, a cada R$200 em compras com seu Visa cadastrado, você tem a chance de ficar mais perto do sonho de assistir ao Super Bowl 59. E usando seu cartão de débito, você ainda concorre a prêmios diários de até R$1.000. Não importa o tamanho do seu sonho, dê o primeiro passo. Visa, apoiando seus passos aonde você quiser chegar.
All right, let's keep rolling here. Let's get into the Sunday afternoon slate. We've got 4 games left. You would think with two Monday night games, we might, you know, get done a little quicker, but that's not how this podcast ever rolls. So let's dive into it. 49ers at Patriots. 49ers bounce back from back-to-back road losses with a win 30-13. It still wasn't perfect. They had an opening 90-yard drive that ended in a field goal. They had a turnover that they got at the 30 that also ended in a field goal, but it was a big step in the right direction. Brock Purdy didn't even play particularly well, I didn't think, but he put up 288 yards and a touchdown with an interception. Jordan Mason continues to play well. He had 123 yards and a touchdown on the ground. He had 37 receiving yards. Here's a fun stat for you, Mark. Jordan Mason's 447 rushing yards in the first four games is the second most in franchise history. Do you know who the most is?
I don't.
It's Christian McCaffrey last year at 459. So he's only 12 yards behind what Christian McCaffrey did at the start of last season. It's incredible that he's been able to step in. And, you know, at this point, if you're the 49ers, if Jordan Mason continues to play this well, you just like rest Christian McCaffrey until December. I don't know. But the defense played well. Nick Bosa had 9 pressures and a strip sack. Overall, they sacked Jacoby Brissett 6 times. Fred Warner had a 45-yard pick 6 in this one. He did leave the game with an ankle injury, though, so that's worth monitoring as the 49ers continue to lose guys to injuries. What were your thoughts on this one?
Honestly, I wasn't too plugged in on this game, so what I'm going to do instead of that is I am going to give you what I think, you know, this upcoming schedule for the 49ers. They should win this week. They're playing Arizona at home. They're a big favorite. After that, it is brutal. They go at Seattle, Kansas City at home, Dallas at home, at Tampa Bay, Seattle, at Green Bay, at Buffalo, at Chicago, the Rams. And it softens up a bit at Chicago, but that like one, that's 7 game run, Seahawks, Niners, Dallas, Bucks, Seahawks again, Packers, Bills, like that's a pretty brutal run. I think we're going to find out a lot about this 49ers team even before they get some of those pieces back. So I don't know if they'll be able to rest Christian McCaffrey until December or whatever it is, because yeah, Jordan Mason has all those rushing yards, but he's not a factor in the passing game and a threat in the passing game the way McCaffrey is. So I think ultimately that caught up to them a little bit last week, but I think it'll catch up to them more against some of these better offenses.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's get to Kansas City at Los Angeles, the Chargers, I guess I should say. Travis Kelce finally showed up in this game, Mark. He's alive. 7 receptions for 89 yards. It more than doubled his season yardage. Now, they were forced to lean on Kelce after Rashee Rice left the game in the first quarter with an injury. Ironically, it was on a tackle by Patrick Mahomes after an interception. All we really know at this point is after the game, Andy Reid said, quote, "It's not good. There's fears of an ACL tear." He was going to have an MRI today. I'm sure by the time you listen to this, that news will be out. But
Is it out? No, not that news. Ian Rappaport just tweeted, "The Jets situation with Hassan Reddick still has no resolution, and some wondered if the Jets could trade him back to the Eagles. Turns out, per NFL rules, not possible. Teams can't trade a player, then reacquire him via trade until 2 years elapse." That seems kind of crazy, actually, that for 2 years you can't trade back. But
I guess that's in place to like keep you from like, hey, yeah, we're out of the playoffs, we'll trade you this guy for a 4th round pick and then you send him back or something. I don't know.
Yeah, no, I think that there's probably reasons for it, but that absolutely means Howie tried to do it, right?
Absolutely.
It absolutely means Howie called. Maybe even had to look up the rules and say, yeah, that's funny. That's absolutely what happened.
Yeah.
That's great.
I'm definitely
I had that to stop you because I didn't want to lose that thought.
Yeah. So the Chiefs go to 4-0, but if they really did lose Rashee Rice for the rest of the season, that would be devastating. I mean, they already lost Hollywood Brown in the preseason. They lost Isaiah Pacheco in week 2. Injuries continue to mount for the Chiefs too. And Justin Herbert in this game on the Chargers side, he was up in the air with an ankle injury, but he played. And they were missing both offensive tackles, so you could argue if that was a good idea. But He started out well, going 7 of 7 in the first quarter with a touchdown, but he only went 9 of 20 after that. And there was a time period from like the 6-minute mark of the first quarter until the early fourth quarter where they only got 2 first downs. So rough game for the Chargers, rough game for the Chiefs. The Chiefs do get the win, and Patrick Mahomes improved to 13-12 in games where the Chiefs have trailed by double digits. He is the only quarterback in NFL history with a winning record in those circumstances. Just for context, Tom Brady was 36-61 in such games. So there's another insane Patrick Mahomes stat for you, Mark. I know you collect those. What were your thoughts on this game?
I think he also, did he break the record of, was it last week or this week that he broke the record of most wins in their first 100 games, and he did it in his first like 98 or something? I know that just happened as well, either this week or last week. I'm not worried about the Chiefs offense at all. People are like throwing that out there. He had a bad pick. I know Rashee Rice got hurt. Xavier Worthy stepped up and made a big play. They're going to probably trade for whoever, DeAndre Hopkins, Deontay Johnson, whoever, whatever receiver you want to say that's on a bad team. I'm assuming they'll probably make a trade. I actually liked how Kareem Hunt looked. They had him before way back, and he's been out of the league. So he was terrible last season when he did play. But Samaje Perine and Carson Steele were not getting the job done out there. And it was making my Isaiah Pacheco is just a guy and anybody could be the running back for them take look bad. But then Kareem Hunt came in and I was like, oh, okay, there we are. We're back on that take. And I think he could actually give them a little bit in the passing game as well. He had 2 catches there. I think the Chiefs offense is just fine and will be just fine going forward. Feels like they just know how many plays exactly they need to make to win a game. It's like, all right, we're down 3. If we go 3 and out here, we could score the next possession. And then we'll be able to hold the ball and they won't score again. And then we'll just win by a touchdown. Like, it just feels like every week is like, all right, wait until the Chiefs are plus money and live bet them, which I did yesterday when they were down 10-0 and the Chargers had the ball. I bet them at plus 125. They finished the teaser for me as well. But yeah, I said in the preseason that I thought the Chiefs defense, you know, last year we saw the Chiefs have a legitimate top 5 defense. And I didn't think that, you know, just year to year, we talk about it all the time with a lot of teams. Defenses, it bounces kind of all around. Like the top flight defenses, I'm trying to think of the right way to explain this. If you look at the top 5 to 10 offenses year to year, a lot of the times it doesn't change all that much because of those teams and those quarterbacks stay pretty good for a while offensively. With the defense, there's very little kind of teams that stay in the top or stay at the bottom. You're usually either going to regress to the mean either way. So the Chiefs, however, looks like they're probably just going to be an elite defense again. They gave up 20 to the Ravens. I thought their defense looked great in that game. Only 17 to the Falcons, only 10 to the Chargers here. They didn't look great against Cincy, but they made a couple big plays happen. So that's kind of the mark of a good defense. Even when you give up some points, you give up 25 points, you go out and you make some turnovers happen and you change the game. So I think the Chiefs have one of the best defenses in football, and I'm buying in on it. I probably shouldn't have just sold stock on the defense because of L'Jarius Sneed and a couple guys leaving. I think they're still absolutely one of the most talented defenses in football. So I buy in on that.
All right. Let's go to Cleveland, where the Las Vegas Raiders win 20-16 against, you know, the Raiders were down Max Crosby and Devontae Adams, and they were down 10-0 early, but they were able to claw their way back in and win the game. The Browns had 2 huge penalties in this game that were big swings. A 3rd down roughing the passer call that extended a drive that led to a Raiders touchdown. And then a holding call that wiped out an 82-yard touchdown for the Browns. Amari Cooper also had a tipped ball into the air for an interception. Just kind of a disaster class for Cleveland once again offensively. And for the Raiders, their run game finally had a really good performance, but it was mostly due to Alexander Mattison, who had 60 yards on 5 carries. Zamir White only had 50 yards on 17 carries, but they got creative. They had 4 non-running backs with carries for positive yards, including rushing touchdowns by wide receivers Trey Tucker and DJ Turner. It's the first time a team has had multiple wide receiver rushing touchdowns since 2009. When the Jets did it with Jericho Cotchery and Brad Smith. So Raiders getting creative. They come out with the win there. Any thoughts on this one?
The Raiders were up 20-10, and then they give up a fumble, and the Browns return it for a touchdown. the Browns miss that extra point. So that hurts them. Instead of being down three, they're down four. After that point, the Browns had four opportunities to get a drive together and put points on the board. They failed at all four opportunities when down 20-16. Deshaun Watson's a joke. And you look at this, you look at the box score, and his box score is probably the best he's had this year. 24-32, 176 yards, a touchdown and a pick, not saying much. But 16 points, six of those points are because he returned a fumble. The Browns offense scored 10 points today, like without Max Crosby, without the defense's best player on the field. And this is after last week where Deshaun Watson did run 32 yards for eight carries. He was asked last week if maybe after some success with some running as the quarterback against the Giants, if he'd be open to or go to the head coach to discuss more designed runs. Did you see his answer to that, Shane?
Yeah, I did.
He's not a running back. I'm here to throw the football. If I get hurt, then we're all screwed. Guess what, buddy? If you get hurt, everyone in the world is better off. The Browns fan base is better off. The roster is better off. They'd be better. The NFL community would be better off to not have to watch you on football Sundays. Deshaun Watson, you are a loser. That's the only take to have about this game. The Raiders won it. Good for them. They fought back after a bad loss last week. This is all about the Browns having every opportunity and their defense giving them the opportunity, not only by holding the team to 20 points, but by giving them a fumble. They scored a touchdown for them. And this is after last week where they opened the game recovering a fumble on the 10-yard line and scored a touchdown to go up 7-0, and then they lost the rest of the game 21-8 to the New York Giants. By the way, the next time the Eagles play football will be against Deshaun Watson and the Cleveland Browns.
Yeah. Got a comment here coming in from Joe Ciccoletti. Asks, does Nicholas Chubb coming back change the Browns into a winning team?
Absolutely not.
I actually did not know his first name was Nicholas. I feel like Nick Chubb is one thing. Yeah, if it's Nicholas Chubb, I feel like we needed the third or something after it. So
yeah.
It needs to be like Nicholas Chubb the third.
And they ran the ball well here. Jerome Ford, 10 carries, 58 yards. Like, that's not the problem.
Jameis Winston being the quarterback might help things out a little bit, but
absolutely. They'd be a 500 or better team if Jameis Winston was the quarterback.
All right, let's get into the last game. Sunday Night Football. Baltimore just dismantles Buffalo 35-10. This was the Derrick Henry game on the Ravens' first play of the game. He rushed for 87-yard touchdown, and he never stopped. He had 24 carries for 199 yards. Too bad he didn't get one more yard to get that 200-yard game. But he did have a fumble in the fourth quarter, but Patrick Ricard recovered it for a touchdown. So it really he's just showing the love to his fullback there, making sure he got the touchdown, I think. But, I mean, you and I talked about the Ravens are a toe out of bounds and a blown 10-point fourth-quarter lead away from being 4-0. They may be the best 2-0 team or 2-2 team I've ever seen. They lead the league in DVOA. They're a really good football team. And, Lamar, not flashy in this game, 13 of 18 for 156 yards and two touchdowns. He also rushed for 54 and a touchdown. He did have a fumble. He probably should have been picked on one play, but it was a good performance for him. It was a devastating performance up front for the Ravens. Just destroyed the Bills. And for Buffalo, I mean, I feel like Buffalo's really good. Fans just need to burn the tape on this one and move on. They were playing on a short week on the road, and they got whacked out of the gate. I mean, you're down 21-3 after three possessions, and they just couldn't bring it back. Josh Allen was pressured on 44% of his dropbacks. He had an incredible throw, like sprinting to the sideline and hitting Khalil Shakir. I feel like Josh Allen leads the league in throws made within a yard of the sideline, like falling out of bounds. He also had a fumble loss later in the game, but for the Bills, just flush it and move on. But for the Ravens, man, they look, despite their 2-2 record, they look really good.
Yeah. The Ravens are the second best. I mean, if the Ravens were 3-1 even, or let's say if the Ravens were 4-0, we would absolutely be considering them the best team in football. Because they beat the heck out of Buffalo. They won last week against the Cowboys in Dallas. they would have a win in Kansas City if Isaiah Likely's shoe size is a half a size smaller and they went for it on two, which they were. They scored that touchdown. They were going for it on two. So probably a 60% chance they were going to win that game if that was a touchdown. But I think the Ravens undoubtedly to me, I think Kansas City kind of just like holds the number one power ranking spot regardless of how they look. And they are 4-0. So they kind of have earned that in their own way without winning a game by more than 7 points. But I think there's no team in the NFL, and you could argue Minnesota, there's no team in the NFL that's looked better than Baltimore that I think is at all sustainable. And you look at what Baltimore's done. People were freaking out after that Raiders loss. And I said, yeah, this is a game you had to have because the schedule's so hard. But, you know, you just went to Dallas. You beat them. You just beat Buffalo. Like, maybe the schedule doesn't have to be hard if you're the best team. I think the Ravens are right back in the mix. If they can ever get over the Patrick Mahomes hump, then they'll win a Super Bowl. But I don't know if they will.
Yeah. Final question here from Joe Ciccoletti, and we'll get out of here. He says, if you need a game-winning drive out of the quarterbacks in the league, what is your ranking? He's got Mahomes 1 and Lamar 2. Mark, who are you looking to for a game-winning drive, excluding Mahomes?
I'd have to think about it. I will say this is like an uncharacteristic answer I'll give. Stafford is probably in the conversation. Stafford's really good in those situations. But yeah, I think it's probably Lamar, because especially with his legs as such a weapon. People aren't going to want to hear this. I do think Jalen's in like the top 5 to 10 just because of the legs. Like, I think Jaden Daniels is probably, without even seeing that he's done it, I think it probably is. How many times with the mobile quarterbacks, I feel like, have we, and Josh Allen does the same thing, have we seen these guys at the end of games use their legs to get that extra 5-10 yards that ends up being the difference between getting the field goal? So Mahomes, Lamar, Stafford were the first three that came to my mind. Josh Allen's probably 4. After that, I do think guys like, I would just start taking guys like Jalen and Jaden Daniels that can run. Yeah.
Matthew Stafford leads the league in game winning drives among active quarterbacks. So who do you think's number 2 among active quarterbacks?
It's got to be someone older. I don't think it's Aaron Rodgers, because I don't think you would have asked me it the way you did. I'll say Kirk Cousins.
Kirk Cousins is number 5.
Where's Rodgers?
Number 4.
Hmm.
You're not going to get 2, 3, or 6.
Derek Carr, is he one of them?
Derek Carr is 3.
Yeah.
Russell Wilson's 2.
I wouldn't have gotten Russ because I'm not thinking of him as a starter. Yeah.
Andy Dalton is 6.
Yeah, I wouldn't have gotten that either. Derek Carr, I should have got Carr earlier. I knew that stat actually because I've heard it kind of referenced, but yeah.
Yeah. I feel like I would take Allen. But Allen also does some boneheaded things sometimes. But yeah, Allen, Lamar would be my 2-3 for sure, in whatever order.
I think Stafford's right there.
Stafford deserves that mention as well.
He just seems especially good in those spots. Like, even if he's worse than those other guys throughout the rest of the game, it feels like if Stafford has the ball and he's within a touchdown or a field goal, it feels like he's getting it.
Yeah. All right. Well, that's going to do it. Thank you guys for joining us for episode number 172 of Chalk Talk. If you enjoy what you heard on the show, and we know that you do, make sure you smash that subscribe button, turn on notifications so you don't miss our next episode. Subscribe to the Eagles Pinpool podcast feed. You get 6 shows a week, long form shows, daily updates, quick hitters in the morning. So make sure you are checking that out. You can follow us on Twitter. I am at Shane Half NFL. He is at Mark Henry Jr. And we will catch you guys next time.